So actually speaking, the scheme is really treating the rivers like, as Ramaswamy Iyer, Professor Ramaswamy Iyer says, you're treating them like plumbing, you know, you are, these are like pipelines and you're just plumbing, laying down lines from one end to another. So what is the, you know, so one thing is that this river linking thing is actually not a new thing. It's not a new idea. It's not even a very novel idea. But what is happening is, for the, they have tried to take sort of many schemes together into one big sort of gigantic scheme. But otherwise, river linking or interbasin transfers has very much been a part and parcel of water resource development in this country. Just few names I will mention. There were some many earlier attempts. This Periyar project, I think, is late 18 something or maybe even early 19.
115 years now.
More than 100 years. This again very old project. And the BS Satluj link is again a part of the more recent sort of schemes. This is a schematic of the BS Satluj and Ravi rivers. So this is the Satluj, this is the Bias, and this is the Ravi, and this is the somewhere here. Yeah, this I think is the Bhakra Dam, Bhakra Nangal Dam. And after the Bhakra Nangal Dam was completed, they actually put another dam here on the Bias and diverted the waters, a lot of waters of the Bias, into the Bhakra reservoir, and then from there into the Bhakra Kamand. So this was called as the Bias Satluj link. 77 the project was inaugurated. So we have been seeing these cases. You know, so the river linking as such is not a new thing. Yes, similar purpose to augment. In fact, because the area which was supposed to be commanded by Bhakra project was not such a, I mean, there was not enough water in the Bhakra dam or this thing. They wanted to augment it, so they brought it from here. And then there is a fall in the height over here. So there is a open channel here, there's a small reservoir, and there's a dam here. I mean, there is a hydropower project here, hydropower station, from where the water comes into the Bias River. So there is, I think, about 900 megawatts of power generation happening over there, and additional irrigation is created in the Bhakra Kamand. Of course, there are many serious impacts here down in Bias. So that's a part of what happens when water is diverted. So when we look at some of the implications, we can look at that. But basic purpose was that, to augment in one, though. A difference in the sense is that it is not justified in that language of surplus and deficit basin. Satluj was not really called a deficit basin, and Bias was not called a surplus, but generally the idea was that, you know, we can take this water into that basin. And of course, this latest and I think most interesting case of river linking, the Narmada Sabarmati link, which I think yesterday we spoke a little about, where the Narmada dam water is being diverted into the Sabarmati river to create the river front. I just thought I will show you a few scenes of how that operates. So this is Sabarmati in the middle of Ahmedabad river, Ahmedabad city. There's a bit of a digression, I'm sorry, but I can't resist it. This is Sabarmati in the middle of Ahmedabad city. And this is just a little ahead, same Sabarmati. So you can see suddenly the waters have appeared into the river in the city. And then, you know, from where did they come? So this is the Narmada canal which is coming, and the water is being poured into Sabarmati river. So a little bigger picture, that's the Narmada canal which is coming, and here this is actually an outlet into which this water is being let out into Sabarmati.
It's more or less like a lake, you know, that
river. Yes, because they have put a little barrage down, and then they have created that this thing. So, and this is how the 10 kilometers of Sabarmati within Ahmedabad city has become a beautiful, nice, whatever, water body. And yes, the Sabarmati model is being talked about, a model of river beautification. Yes, what is your question?
Is canal going
overhead? No, no. Overhead means ahead of that, is it? Upar. No, it's below the river. Below the river. Below the river. So the Narmada canal, actually, when it goes over the river, when it crosses several rivers, either it goes as an aqueduct or it goes as a below the river. There are many different places where they have taken. Oh, the original flows of the Sabarmati have been gone for many years. So, no, because the Sabarmati, the problem is, like, Sabarmati was one of the first developed rivers. So you had a dam which diverted almost all the water. The only thing that was coming into it was the sewage from Ahmedabad city and of course miscellaneous industries which were flooding it. So there's no water of Sabarmati of its own. After that, it sort of just dissipates and goes into the Sabarmati as a flow. So they have actually sort of held the water within those 10 kilometers. What they have done is the it's sort of bonded to create the river front. So what they actually did was the Sabarmati River in Ahmedabad, they actually cleaned up the river bank, meaning all the slums and all which were there, they were displaced from there, they were taken out. In fact, there was a very strong fight by those, and ultimately they got some alternate accommodation, but essentially they were thrown out. Then they cemented part of that, like they didn't actually canalize the river is not canalized or channelized, but they have cemented the banks into, you know, like nice clean steps, and so that you have, and then you have those water steady there, then you know you have some parks and all kind of stuff. So actually those pictures are also interesting to see, but I think we would have got too sidetracked, so I didn't get into that.
That's a temporarily borrowed river.
Yes. Yeah. So the important point is that this is the Sabarmati model of river rejuvenation, urban river rejuvenation has been talked about as, you know, they are going to replicate that in other areas, and of course that's a problem. That is, for rejuvenating any river in this country, we need to allow some water to flow in the river. And that means we'll have to accept that water cannot be used for something else. And that's in fact also the notion of the environmental flow, you know. And that actually goes against what we are talking about is a new paradigm of approaching river development. The so far the said and unsaid paradigm of river development has been every drop of water in the river has to be put to human use, either diverted or in some other way. Any drop of water that is reaching the sea is a waste. And these are the words which the government documents use, the planning commission documents use. So if we are in that paradigm, no river can really be cleaned up. But if we adopt a paradigm where at least some water can flow in a river, then we are talking about the possibility of rejuvenating a river. We'll have to do other things also, but this definitely. In fact, that is one of the big issues when you talk about this whole notion of surplus and deficit. What is a surplus? Any water that is flowing in the river, if you say it's just flowing waste and it's a surplus, you can divert it, then, you know, it will, you know, kill the river, to use a sort of a loaded word. But otherwise, how will a project like the river linking be possible if you are not able to, you know, classify a lot of this water as surplus water? So in fact, we are coming to that. I think that is the key notion of that surplus and this thing. So again, I'll just quickly run through what are the issues and problems. But this is where we start with the first. So I think the first and the most fundamental issue and the problem with this river linking project is again with the notion of surplus and deficit. Two, three different ideas. One is if there are floods, then it can be considered surplus. Yeah, 1 minute. Let me just summarize. One idea is that no water in river can be considered surplus because it is performing some or the other function. One notion is a comparative thing. Like here, if the water runoff is more than somebody else, then it's so there is a comparative thing about surplus. Again, two more notions. One is that enough irrigation has not been developed, or all possible irrigation has not been developed in a basin, so it appears that there is some water flowing in that, and therefore there is a, you know, it seems to be surplus. Another this thing of surplus is you take all your demands, how much water you need for domestic use, how much water you need for irrigation and for industrial use, and then you, whatever is remaining is surplus. Now, of course, as you can imagine, that all this is very heavily loaded stuff, because technically you are right that there is no water surplus in a river because every bit of water is performing some or the other use, and we'll see some of that, just a little sample of some of those things. There is some logic to this that, okay, after all the needs of that basin are satisfied, maybe what can be considered as surplus. But how do you know that, say, industrial need of that area has been satisfied? You may want to put more industries and more, so then the need will go up. So what is the need itself is also a big question. And then, of course, what are the uses which are considered when you derive a surplus? And they all this is also a big problem in this project. So I'll just come to why and how. So first, as I said, this notion of surplus and deficit itself is very problematic. particularly in the way it is used and defined for this project. So there is a complete lack of recognition that different water flows represent different ecosystems. Okay, just because a river dries up in some seasons, it's a seasonal river, doesn't mean it is deficit in water. It represents a different ecosystem. Just because a river is perennial, like say Brahmaputra has so much water, it doesn't mean that it has excess water. It's a different ecosystem. So I think this very important notion is completely lost track of, and that is the reason is because a river is just looked at as a source of water which is to be extracted for human use. Once you narrow your frame to that, then of course, everything is just counted in those terms. So there is a complete lack of recognition, and this is of course the reason why we have all the other problems also associated with rivers. That's why you can, very easily dam the Narmada, take the water, dump it into Sabarmati and let it go back again into the sea without, feeling anything about it. In fact, projecting it as a big achievement. So that I think is a basic fundamental problem with this project. Joy mentioned, I think that's also a very important thing, that rivers are carriers of sediment, and when you block, transfer, divert rivers, you play havoc with that sediment, which also has an impact all the way up to the deltas.
Delta, yeah.
So, coming back to this notion of that water, different water flows represent different ecosystems, we now have a new sort of emerging tool or a method or an approach of the environment flows or e-flows, which is the, because it's a major issue in all river basins. Environmental flow, which means how much flow should be flowing in a river. It's called environmental flows, but I think particularly in the Indian context, we should also define that as a flow which meets the requirements of the river and the basin ecology, but also the, basic needs of the communities on the basin, the livelihood needs, the cultural and the social needs of the basin. So I think in the Indian context, this environmental flows or e-flows are basically flows to keep the river flowing and performing all these functions. So the environmental flows in all rivers, river basins are becoming a very major issue. Okay. And method or the approach of environmental flow shows that our current notion of surplus is a very limited and wrong understanding. So I think we need to expand our notion of the functions and roles of the river, which are then used to define a surplus. We need to expand that. Now, this is something new maybe in the formal knowledge systems, but I think even 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, I can't speak for before that, but struggles and movements and people were actually talking about all these issues. They may not be using this word, but they were saying that river needs to be alive, river is needed for this, river is needed for that. So that notion has been around, but of course, it has not got mainstream legitimacy. But through the approach of, through the approach of environmental flows, this notion and understanding that a river needs to flow and river needs, the water in the river is needed for many different functions is gaining more acceptance, and some level of understanding is emerging. And I think that understanding will critically redefine the notion of surplus as understood by the river linking project. Two points. I think the second point is much easier to be answered. In fact, I won't go into the details. The second point was whether there has been any more specific sort of quantification or more detailing of the impacts. The answer is yes. For example, if you take the Ken Betwa project, again, projects which are, more developed. So if you look at the Ken Betwa project, lot of detailed analysis. For example, Himanshu Thakkar of Sander, he has done very detailed analysis of the impact. Polavaram project, there are very serious critique, and there is a very strong, some movement on the ground also is going on. So where the details of the project are known and some things are happening, I think those critiques are available. So I won't get into those because I think some of those are known. Your first question is, I think, far more important from a principle or a notional point of view, that there is a natural state of the river, and then there is a choice which society makes to alter that natural state, and a choice which is made by by us 10 years back or 20 years back may seem to be a wrong choice today. So I think that's really the critical point, that of course not any or many rivers are in the natural state any longer. There are some, but not many. And we are also saying that yes, we need to use the water of the rivers. So the question is really about how much and in what manner. And I think those are the things which are being challenged. the kind of mainstream approach which has been there since last so many years has been doing it in a very, you know, particular manner, say very engineering oriented manner, or in the thinking that even one drop of water which is wasted is, you know, I mean, not used is wasted. But there is a need for a change in perspective. The second point I wanted to emphasize is that the choices made by the society 30 years ago may seem wrong today, and, you know, because we are learning and all that. So that's one, definitely one part of it, that we made some choices at the level of our knowledge and understanding at that point of time. And today, looking back, those choices seem to be wrong and we need to change that. But that's not the only reason why we are making wrong choices. Wrong choices are also made because the choices are dictated by those who are more powerful politically and economically, and only their voice and their interests count largely. So even 30 years ago, 40 years ago, there were other voices which were articulating a different vision, but those were not heard. So I think that also is an important reality which we must keep in mind. So I'll come back to some of those things. That I think the key question is, how do we, even if we decide we want to divert water, how do we decide, and what are the criteria? So I think those are the critical issues that we need to think about.